Global Asset Management's insights for the post-pandemic world. We are all looking forward to a post-pandemic world. This is the third event in our multi-part Trends in Asset Management series. My name is Katie Grady, and I'm Dean of the Brandeis International Business School and the Fred and Rita Richmond Distinguished Professor in Economics. To those of you who are members of our community, alumni, faculty, students, staff, and friends, I am so glad you have decided to join us. And for those of you who have an interest in today's topic, but are not formally affiliated with Brandeis, it is wonderful to have you with us for this important event, and we hope you remain in touch with our school and university. This series is sponsored by the Baupost Group and the International Business School's Rosenberg Institute of Global Finance. The Rosenberg Institute is an integral part of our school that was founded and funded by Barbara and Dick Rosenberg. As a global business school, we are very proud of our school's long-term strength in student and alumni outcomes in the global finance industry. I also want to acknowledge our India initiative, which seeks to build and strengthen ties in India among academic, corporate, and alumni partners. My sincere thanks to Ruben Auspitz, class of 69, a member of our board of advisors, for his vision and support of the India initiative. We will be recording this event and sharing it on our various platforms in a few days. Please keep an eye out for it and be sure to share it with your networks. I also want to remind our guests that today is Giving Dice Day, Brandeis's version of Giving Tuesday International Day of Philanthropy. Your gift to the International Business School will make a real difference in the lives of our students. Thanks to the generosity of one of our donors, all gifts up to $15,000 to the International Business School will be matched today. You can learn more at givingdiceday.brandeis.edu. The link is in the chat. Thank you very much for your support. Finally, I'd like to introduce our moderator for today's program, Professor Debarshi Nandi. Debarshi is the Barbara and Richard M. Rosenberg Professor of Global Finance and the director of our India initiative. Thank you, Debarshi, and please take it away.
Thank you, Dean Grady, for that introduction. I would also like to welcome everybody to this webinar, and we are looking forward to an exciting discussion today. So over the last decade, the asset management industry has faced several challenges, the most prominent likely being the shift from actively managed funds to passive funds over the last several years. This AUM, of which has grown to roughly around 11.5 trillion globally at the end of 2019, beginning of 2020. And this has led to margin compression for the asset management industry and has likely influenced various industry consolidation and other decisions in the recent past. Over time, one might worry that if such trends persist, it might impact the efficiency of financial markets or even the standards of corporate governance in firms. If the largest passive funds end up being the majority stakeholders, shareholders in all publicly traded firms, these worries might have different implications. On the other hand, during this time, the asset management industry has also seen great opportunities as well with the emergence of niche focus areas such as ESG investing, climate finance, growing opportunities in private markets and other areas. These challenges and opportunities have been impacted by this recent pandemic we are in the midst of and hopefully coming out of it soon. And while on one hand, it has dramatically sped up innovation and growth through digital channels, and on the other hand, as we stand today, the world faces an uncertain economic future with varying rates of expected economic recovery in different countries across the globe. So as countries look to emerge from this global pandemic and the associated economic impact, corporate leaders across the asset management industry need to adapt to a variety of changes that have impacted global business during this pandemic, as well as political, social, public health realities across the different countries. So we have three excellent panelists who are joining us today from around the world to discuss these and more issues surrounding how the asset management industry is looking to emerge from this pandemic. And it is my pleasure to introduce them to you. I would like to introduce Deborah Bannon, who is the head of institutional distribution and consultant relations at BNY Mellon, who is joining us from Hong Kong. Deborah, hello.
Thank you, Dibashi. Hello.
Hi, welcome, Deborah. Sanjay Sachdev, who is the former CEO of Tata Asset Management in India and currently the chairman of Zyfin Holdings, who is joining us from New Delhi in India. Hello, Sanjay. Welcome.
Hello, Dibashi.
And Perry Traquina, who is the chair of our asset management board at Brandeis International Business School, alum of 78, former CEO and chairman of Wellington Asset Management in the United States, and currently the director at Morgan Stanley, Allstate, and eBay. Welcome, Perry.
Thank you, Dibashi. Morning, everybody.
So good morning, all. Deborah, if you could turn on your video, there we go. Great, thanks. So I would like to start off by asking each of you, each of our panelists, a question on, you know, what their current thoughts and interests are in the asset management world, and what you think might be the main geopolitical challenges facing the industry as the world emerges from this pandemic. You know, are there any particular trends that we should look forward to, or any issues that we might worry about? Deborah, we could get started with you.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, I mean, in my role as head of institutional distribution for the Asia Pacific region, you know, I guess the one thing, obviously, I'm covering a lot of a very diverse client base across very diverse regions, all the way from Australia through to North Asia and Southeast Asia. The one thing that I guess has been very interesting for us to consider here is how some of these really large asset owners have gone about thinking about the impact of the pandemic on their portfolios, what that means for them in terms of their longer term strategic asset allocation. Does it mean, you know, they need to reconsider more opportunistic allocations to things that they may not have considered before? If so, how do they address the issues of being able to do due diligence on new managers in a world where nobody can travel and portfolio managers are unable to visit the Asia region? So, you know, what we have seen in particular, you know, if you'd have asked me probably back in January before this really impacted us on a global basis, you know, it was much more of a risk on environment. It very quickly became much more of a risk off environment. And asset owners had to very, very quickly think, and they had to rely on their asset managers or their asset consultants of how they were going to protect their portfolios. And then as it's gone on and as it's been prolonged, I think the thing that we're seeing is that they're realizing that traditional diversification in their portfolios hasn't really helped them to a certain degree to protect on the downside. And obviously, you know, this is a downside that no one could have considered at the beginning of the year was going to happen, and to the impact it has. Some of the larger asset owners we've seen in the region have certainly taken advantage of that. They've taken advantage of the dislocation in markets and they've done very well out of that. Others have taken a very hands-off approach, decided that in the absence of being able to do any non-virtual type of due diligence, that they will stick with their existing lineup of investment managers. So it's really been a bit of a mixed bag. I don't think there's been a particular trend. There's also been clearly now, as we've, you know, this has been very prolonged. We've seen, or certainly, you know, from my perspective, in terms of the investment firms that we represent in the region, we are seeing more demand for ESG I think it's been heightened or highlighted that it's not only something that can is for the greater good, it's also something that is a huge risk mitigator in this current environment. So we're definitely seeing increased demand from asset owners across the whole of the Asia Pacific region. And we are also seeing some of the larger asset owners that are looking at private markets in a different way and increasing their allocations to private markets. Thank you.
Thanks, Deborah. Perry, what are your thoughts on these?
You know, I think the pandemic in some ways hasn't changed several of the trends that were pre-existing coming into 2020. Debarshi, you mentioned several of them, the shift to passive, pressure on fees, revenue pressures, cost pressures, you know, the shift to alternatives, privates. You know, these trends were existent prior to March of this year and are likely to persist. And in, you know, like other industries, the pandemic has probably accelerated certain trends, and, you know, the ultimate impact on the industry, I think, is still to be seen. But, you know, Deborah mentioned, you know, a heightened focus on ESG, DEI by institutional investors, work from home. You know, how many of those folks will actually go back to the office is unclear. There's an opportunity there to rationalize expenses if you're a large asset manager and find ways to be more efficient by shrinking your cost base via real estate. So I think some of those trends are different relative to you know, where we were coming into the year. But for the most part, I think the industry faces several sort of structural challenges. It's mature, low growth. And, you know, if you were running an asset management company today, I think the trends that, you know, were in place coming into the year are still the trends that you need to be focused on over the next 5 years.
Thanks, Barry. Sanjay, from your vantage point, what do you see?
Well, I think that there's a little bit of both of what Perry and Deborah said. I think that there's clearly been disruption. The pandemic has brought in some element of disruption, but a lot has not changed. These were trends that were continuing prior to the pandemic. If you look at ETF flows, specifically from a passive, active to passive perspective, you know, we've now seen the ETF industry grow to about $5 trillion in assets. This continues to surpass all expectations. So the focus really is, from an investor perspective, to look at how they can access markets at a much more cheaper cost and a more efficient basis. While having said that, I think that clearly from an asset management industry perspective, this disruption is leading to what you would say is more opportunities in some ways in terms of trying to look out for more outside of their comfort zone and look at other markets to see how they can expand their scope. So I think this is, you know, disruption can be positive and negative. I think in this case, it looks like it'll probably be a lot more positive over the years to come in terms of global integration.
Great. So I want to pick on one of the, you know, one of the ideas that just came about. You know, Deborah, you mentioned about many fund managers, you know, given the absence of due diligence or the ability to do due diligence properly, have relied on their past holdings or their past experience and gone with those that focus. Do you see this impacting performance going forward in time?
Potentially, yes, if I'm being honest, to a certain degree. Part of that is the fact that I'm speaking purely from a you know, what I'm seeing in the Asia Pacific region with the asset owners here. But part of that is that potentially asset allocation decisions that were intended to be made to improve overall portfolio returns over time have not been made. So they haven't changed, they haven't diversified, they've enriched you know, the mandates that they have with existing managers. So it may have caused a little bit of concentration risk there within their portfolios as well.
Okay. So do you, you know, Perry and Sanjay, I mean, feel free to jump in at any time. What do you think this might, you know, have an impact in terms of, as we look to emerge from this, do you think there is a greater possibility of active managers coming in to take advantage of the current situation or to build strategies that might, you know, the, you know, that might basically be dependent on the emerging economies and I guess what I mean is that the different rates of development or the different rates at which economies emerge from this pandemic. Are there active strategies that might come up from that perspective that could help the active management side?
You know, my two cents there, Debarshi, would be that, you know, the industry's always been pretty innovative. You've had, you know, many, you know, industry formation, new company formation, you know, new hedge funds, you know, have continued probably at a slower pace for the reasons that Deborah outlined, which is it's hard to do due diligence on a, you know, brand new startup when you really can't meet face to face or you're disinclined to meet face to face. But, you know, the industry has always had formations with people spinning out of their old shop and, you know, creating their own firms and starting anew. So I don't think that necessarily has changed. Probably the dynamics around how that actually takes place today has changed because of the pandemic, but I think that will continue.
So Debarshi, I think that to some extent, Perry's right, absolutely. But I think that emerging markets by nature of their being are more inefficient. So active fund management will probably play a significant role comparatively. But having said that, you are already seeing an influx of passives, and not just passives, but I think more alternatives and quantitative styles of management. I think this is going to continue for a relatively longer period of time. But if you take a much more shorter term view of this year alone, I think this year has been very, very devastating for active fund managers because it's very, very difficult, has been very difficult for them to beat the indexes. And I think across the board, not just in the US, but also in emerging markets.
So we have our first question from the audience, which brings up the issue of the global supply chain, the risk of which was exposed during the pandemic, and whether or not that has, what kind of impact might that have on strategies going forward for the asset management industry? So, Deborah, do you want to talk about, a huge part of the supply chain, I guess, you know, depends on China and goods flowing in and out of China. So what do you see or what do you think about the situation there that might have an impact?
I think obviously it's highlighted the fact that if you rely on any one country as a key manufacturing center, it's going to potentially cause some issues. And obviously the ongoing US-China tensions have been something that will continue and regardless of, you know, the current pandemic environment. You know, for me, I think if I was looking now from a perspective of you know, to actually not reassess supply chains and whether or not, you know, you could look to other countries. I mean, what we're seeing in Asia a lot has been some of the smaller emerging markets that are benefiting from this. So, you know, maybe countries like Vietnam or Cambodia, et cetera, which I don't think is a bad thing. I do think going forward, clearly, you know, China is a force to be reckoned with. I don't think people will naturally just not consider whether or not China is their key manufacturer and whether or not they can trade with the country going forward. But I think there's going to be a bit of fallout in that.
Thanks, Deborah. Perry?
Varshi, just on that point, sure. To follow up on what Deborah said, I think maybe this is less pandemic related, but I think the trade tensions and all of the tensions between, say, the US and China have created a certain level of uncertainty regarding, you know, how do you invest in China? There, you know, are companies exposed for, you know, bans or tariffs? We've seen what happened with TikTok. There's been talk about heightened audit standards for Chinese companies in the US and whether or not they'll be allowed to actually be listed on the New York Stock Exchange and other exchanges. I think all of that uncertainty is actually bad for markets. And so I would hope that some of that under the new administration would be ameliorated so that investors can go back to worrying about fundamentals as opposed to some of these political issues, global issues that theoretically could be quite damaging to some of these companies on a go-forward basis. And we're not talking about small companies, we're talking about, you know, large market cap swaths that could theoretically be impacted by this tension. And so I think that has been exposed here and probably creates, you know, risks and uncertainties for investors investing in some of those companies on a go forward basis.
Mm-hmm. Great. So, you know, one of the things, Perry, I also wanted to touch upon, I think, what, you know, both Sanjay and I think all of you have mentioned actually that there are opportunities internationally in terms of active management. And in your view, where do you see the, you know, as we go forward, where do you see the equilibrium headed towards? Like, is the trend of, you know, movement from passive, active to passive, passive going to dominate going forward? Or do you think that, you know, the international globalized or managers would become more international and more globalized in their view as we go forward?
Well, you know, the trend that you just heightened, you know, the shift to passive, I mean, we're really talking about equities, active equities versus passive equities. That's where the brunt of this has taken place. And I think last year was the first year on record where in the US mutual fund industry, the amount of assets in passive ETFs surpassed the amount of equity assets in active funds. So that was a first. That's likely to persist. The shift will continue. But I think what we're seeing is, in addition to that, there's been almost what I would call like a barbelling where institutional investors are shifting a significant portion of their risk budgets away from active equities, say, to passive. But at the same time, they're shifting that risk budget to private markets, whether that's private equity, venture, real estate, and all of the idiosyncratic risks that theoretically go with that, plus liquidity risks, obviously, because if your money is tied up in a 10-year fund, you expect to get paid for that because obviously you have less liquidity. So that barbelling, I think, is what we're seeing. And, you know, from that, yes, if you are if all of your business or, you know, your AUM is in, you know, US active equities, you are fighting against the stream today. your only option, and it's even a hard one, is to find a way to gain market share within a shrinking pie. But if you're a diversified global manager, then there are other areas of opportunity. We've talked about, you know, ESG investing. We've talked about privates. Wealth creation in Asia is continuing at a pretty high rate. So to the degree that you can access those markets through the efforts of, you know, Sanjay and Deborah, you know, there's a significant opportunity for growth there. So I would say overall, it's a mature industry, but within the industry, there are, you know, several pockets of growth that you can pursue in order to get above the fray, in order to, you know, produce above average growth. And, you know, even the largest asset manager globally, BlackRock, is, you know, look at, you know, the most recent results show that, you know, even given their size, which is, you know, the largest, they have been able to produce organic AUM growth in the mid to high single digits, which is quite extraordinary given their size. So their opportunities exist, but I think the backdrop is one of maturation and then, you know, managers needing to find vectors for growth, of which there are several, and trying to position yourself in some of those streams of growth.
Great. So, you know, that, you know, you referred to the potential growth in the Asia-Pac region. And, you know, Deborah and Sanjay, I would like to get your views on this. So, you know, just yesterday, I saw an article in the Financial Times that mentioned that over the last decade, the number of people with wealth greater than 50 million in Asia-Pac has gone up to about 46,000. That same number was about, 15,000 about 10 years ago. And currently, that is greater than that in Europe, which is around 32,000. The US is higher still at double that, around 90,000. But the trend in Asia-Pac has been this dramatic growth of wealth. What do you see, both in India, South Asia, as well as in Southeast Asia and China, about, how this trend is going to continue going forward? Sanjay, perhaps we can start with you.
Sure. Sitting in New Delhi, I can tell you that as Indians generate more wealth, there is a much more larger appreciation of the fact that they need to look at more their asset allocation more from a global perspective rather than just from a Indian perspective. So, you know, the government of India has opened up the market for Indians to invest overseas, and with a small little window of about $250,000 per year per person. And we've started seeing, this started about 5 years ago, and last year they had about $22 billion go outside of India in investments, primarily in the US markets. This year, that's substantially going to be higher. But, you know, coming back to what you said, I think that, you know, this whole active-passive thing, it's not just specifically one against the other, because there's a lot of opportunity for innovation. Who could have thought 5 years ago that you could invest only in cloud computing, for example, or you could invest only in and automated vehicles or specific sectors. So the growth of thematic investing is something that catches the eyes of the millennials a lot more, and Gen Z. And I think that's really what's driving things. Also, the ETF business is really a mix, is getting more and more into a mix of active rather than passive. So there's a substantive growth. I think one of the fastest growing areas for BlackRock today is the active ETF business, actually. And so what we are seeing is that this disruption leads to innovation. And I think from a cross-border perspective, I think specifically in South Asia and Southeast Asia, I'm sure Deborah has probably also can validate the trends, but there is a very big shift in terms of investors wanting to invest more into the US. And also the fact that because of these trade relationship issues with China, there's a significant opportunity for, you know, for US investors to start looking at diversifying and not just focus largely on China risk alone. So there are opportunities to invest in other markets such as Vietnam, Singapore, Malaysia, India, in Southeast Asia.
Thanks, Sanjay. Deborah?
Yeah, I agree with everything Sanjay just said. I mean, you know, on the subject of obviously the growing wealth, I think that will continue. I think it's a trend that we will see continue for a number of years. I can tell you where the money isn't going, though. The money is not generally going into passive, you know. The risk appetite of Asian retail or high net worth investors is so much higher. And, you know, where we're seeing a lot of capital flow into now, if you look at, you know, some of the Broadridge data, for example, that's come out over the last year or so, it will show that those retail flows are going into higher yielding asset classes, and in particular into private markets. I mean, the Asians have always owned, you know, always been big into property anyway, but definitely on the private market side. And just on the topic that you mentioned before on passive versus active, with, you know, I used to be an investment consultant at Mercer before I joined BNY. Investment consultants, for many different reasons, do not believe in this trend that passive will ever overtake active for a number of reasons. I certainly don't see that happening in the Asia Pacific region, not anytime soon. I think there has been a time and a place for it, but if you look at most large institutional asset owners' portfolios across the Asia region, it's generally more like a 10 or 15% allocation that they make to passive versus active. And you get a few exceptions that kind of skew the numbers. If you look at New Zealand Super, GPIF, you know, people like that, then you're gonna see that they have a much larger passive book. But I think there's a place for both in the portfolio. But if we go on in a minute, and I'm sure we will, to talk about things such as ESG, that becomes a much, you know, more difficult conversation to have, is how do you fully and effectively implement ESG in a purely passive portfolio?
I think that's a great segue into talking about ESG, climate finance, and the rest of it. So there has been a trend, all of you have talked about it. So where do you think that there are, you know, there are opportunities here that that one should, or funds are focused on, or that funds should look into? Let's also bring up on the table the definition of ESG as, you know, currently defined. Could we, is that the right way to go forward, or do we need to drill down even more and, you know, really kind of look into it critically? Perry, you want to start us off on this?
You know, it's a broad umbrella, I guess. So, I think you need to try and tease out some of the aspects of that. Let's just focus, for example, on the G, governance part. You know, I think, you know, the large institutional owners of assets now are demanding certain principles, guidance, guidelines, policies regarding governance that all publicly traded companies will at some point need to adhere to or pay attention to. So, and, you know, whether that's, you know, whether a board of directors is sufficiently diverse, whether, you know, a company is sufficiently diverse in terms of its senior leadership team, you know, philosophies, policies on how do you compensate leadership, CEOs, whether a CEO should be both board chair or and CEO. I mean, these are all, you know, aspects of governance that, you know, for many, many years, you know, weren't actively discussed or focused on. But today, I think every board room of a publicly traded company is paying attention to these and making sure that they're doing their best to be on the right side of these metrics with respect to governance. you know, then the other two aspects of ESG, you know, let's focus on climate, environmental. I think there's a whole vector there for growth with respect to not only how you do research, how you think about investing, what are the risks associated with making investments in certain sectors or certain companies. I think all of this is now getting a much, much greater attention, and then funds will be created and have been created, and, you know, large asset managers have created, you know, groups focused on this growth vector. So I think this is just really the beginning. And I think it will permeate many of the conversations that investors will have going forward. And it certainly will occupy many conversations that publicly traded companies will have with respect to all of these metrics, because they are now being monitored and evaluated by not just a small group of investors, but increasingly a very large group of investors, including, by the way, the largest index providers, who have all created, you know, views and published views on ESG, and expect that their, you know, the companies that they now own, of which they own significant portions of, will adhere to. So I think this is a very important and big trend, and one that we should, you know, all be paying attention to.
Great. So let me also get in an audience question that came in on related to this. You know, China recently opened the bond market for international investors. What is your views on managing risk given, you know, with regard to corporate governance, regulatory risk, and financial reporting of Chinese companies? And does the opening also provide an opportunity of Chinese and local investors investing internationally, globally? Deborah, why don't we go to you? Perhaps you can give us your views on ESG also, and talk a little bit about the China market and what it means for them opening up.
Yeah, sure. So just to start with the ESG, everything that Perry said is true. I think, you know, everyone is focused now, not purely just on the governance, and it used to be ESG, but a big focus on a G. But what COVID, I think, has taught everyone, or all investors, is that there needs to be much more of a focus on the environmental and the societal impacts. And it's companies that are paying attention to those that are obviously going to outperform and manage risk in the long term. So definitely a trend that we see continuing. As it relates to the China asset management industry opening up, things have definitely improved. I mean, I've been in the asset management industry in one way or another, either as an asset consultant or, you know, in the asset management world out in Asia for the past 25 years. And, you know, when people first started looking at investing directly into China equity or China bonds, I think there was a lot of concern, especially around governance and, you know, for all the reasons that, you know, we're well aware of and that have been talked about. I think things have, you know, as China starts to actually become more internationalized and they're looking to seek more investment from overseas, they've realized that they've had to take note of some of the issues around not only, you know, ESG and governance in particular, but also what they do on, you know, CSR, you know, corporate social responsibility and areas such as that. And even to the degree that they're now finally looking at, you know, diversity in a different way. So I think all of these things, I think it still takes time for some of those issues to really play out. But I think over time, obviously, you know, they will. The other side of it is clearly international firms being able to operate in China, you know. This year alone, in another year, I think if we hadn't had an environment like we've had COVID happen, the market opening measures that China has taken this year alone would have, you know, gathered a lot more attention internationally than they have, given this COVID environment. I mean, the measures they've taken, like allowing foreign asset managers to take a majority share in a joint venture up to 100%. Things like that you haven't really seen before. But what still hasn't really played out and what we haven't seen is obviously the China wealth, the retail high net worth investors, and what their reaction is to those wholly foreign owned enterprises, you know, launching locally domiciled funds and how popular they are vis-a-vis the locally domiciled funds, that, you know, the big Chinese asset management players. Fantastic. I think there's a way to go.
Okay, thanks, Deborah. Sanjay, what are your thoughts? In particular, also, if you could touch upon from the perspective of Indian financial markets and how ESG is playing out there.
Well, you know, I would like to second a lot of what Perry talked about. I think that, you know, the focus is really on gender rights and on making sure that there is separation of responsibilities and so on. But I think that it's a little too early, if you ask me, because even though ESG is very, very, I would say, popular right now in the asset management world, and everybody's talking about it, and there's a lot of articles written on it, it's still work in progress, because there's a lot of metrics that need to be defined and standardized. So the standards are still not in place yet. I think that that you have the principles of responsible investing, that the UN charter and so on, but that's just the beginning. And I think that in countries like India, specifically the G of the ESG is extremely critical. I mean, from an environmental perspective, India just last week announced, the Indian government announced, that they've actually surpassed the Paris Accord agreements in terms of meeting those targets. So comparatively, even though India had quite a bit of time to actually enter the Paris Accord agreements, including China, which is going to be part of it in 2030. But having said that, I think there's still a lot of work that has to be done on the governance side as far as India is concerned. I think that it's a little too early. The fallacy that remains, and I think that's something that we have to all do something about, is to remove this fallacy that because you're investing in ESG, that doesn't mean that you're not going to get market-related returns, you know, because ESG can give you also market-related returns. So investors should not feel that just because they are looking at trying to do good for society, they're giving up something in return, because that's not true.
Absolutely. So it can be financially profitable as well as...
Absolutely.
Yeah. Correct. Okay.
Yeah, I think just on that subject, I think one of the key things that we're seeing, and this is probably on a global perspective, is the more focus that goes into ESG, and you know, there is continued focus both from a retail and an institutional level. The more challenges the industry is facing, because funds that are labeled ESG are not necessarily ESG. You know, there's a little bit of greenwashing going on here. So I think a lot of that will obviously be sorted out over the next 6 to 12 months, especially as regulators are taking a much more active role now in saying, you know, defining ESG parameters and what it means for fund managers across the world.
But there are practical issues, because, you know, if you look at, say, for example, I'll give you one example of Korea. There are less than three companies that have more than one woman board member as far as Korea is concerned. So you know, it becomes very, very difficult to find equal rights, gender rights, you know, those kinds of things in countries like Korea and others. So I think it becomes very difficult for an ESG portfolio manager to find the right businesses to invest in.
Mm-hmm. There's Perry, before I come to you, let me also, there's an interesting question from one of our audience members. So that touches upon this point about ESG and financial returns and links that to pension fund investments. Given that, there are, some funds have a sort of like an implied guaranteed or expected return component to it, and the belief or and the, you know, the fallacy, Sanjay, that you mentioned, that yes, by investing in ESG, you're kind of giving up a portion of your financial expected return. Do you think that that might have an impact as well in pension investors, for pension investors? Or do you see that happening going forward? Perry, why don't we go back to the broader question and any thoughts you might have on the discussion we just had on the Asian markets
I think Sanjay and Deborah covered that quite well. I guess the point I'd be making is that this trend, I don't think is a fad. I think this is going to be with us for a while. I think it's going to be persistent. I think the expectations surrounding ESG with respect to regulatory bodies, for example, the PRA in the UK is very focused on climate risk. And so all companies will need to be thinking about their impact on the environment. That is not going to go away. And I think increasingly you'll see that in the US as well, whether that's from the SEC or the Fed. And so I think this is going to be persistent. It's unclear whether it has an impact on returns. I mean, we're talking about a very short period of time. I used to say when I was running an asset management firm that the only way to really know if someone can add value or not is over, a decade or two. And so let's take, fossil fuels. I mean, if for some reason fossil fuels as a sector, and it hasn't been, but, did quite well for a period of time, I would guess that would be a drag on all ESG investor returns relative to, say, just a broad index. And so, but I just think that this is going to be persistent. And I think all publicly traded companies are going to need to have thought this through increasingly and have, and they will have to be thoughtful about ESG and their companies. And so I think this is going to be part of the fabric of investing for quite some time.
Great. In the interest of time, I do want to get in your, I want to ask each of you to perhaps make one prediction or what your expectation is about the asset management industry for the next 5 to 10 years. Any trends that you think might be coming up and that we should be paying attention to? Sanjay, why don't we start with you?
Debashi, I think that we are in the middle of a very, what you would say, is a tectonic shift in terms of global integration, because the future really lies in Asia in terms of growth rates for the industry. And I think that on the other hand, Asians want to find ways and means of accessing and investing in the US markets. So I think that you're going to see a lot more of a mesh and an opportunity for U.S. fund managers, for global fund managers, to entrench themselves a lot more. And these are very difficult markets, and I think Perry has a lot more experience with that. But to access these markets is not easy. And it's not going to be just, you're looking at just institutions, because it's really the real juices from focusing on high net worth individuals and the retail market. And I think that the Gen Z in these countries, Gen X, millennials, are all very, very aspirational by nature. And they are looking at what's happening with global trends. So I think that this is going to lead to a lot more opening of the markets. I mean, if you look at, the largest customer base of Facebook in the world is not the US, it's India. The second largest customer base from Amazon in the world, and Amazon's invested $25 billion, is in India today. And it could have been China, but China's been a closed market, right? So I think that it's created a certain opportunity because of the mass numbers of people and middle-income people and wealth that is being generated in these markets. It's going to be a natural fit for asset management businesses to look at these markets. Mm-hmm.
Perry, what are your thoughts?
The one trend that we really haven't talked about which I think will be much more prevalent over the next 5 or 10 years, is I think the industry is going to consolidate. You know, we have a mature industry, and typically what happens with mature industries is that you see consolidation. The asset management industry remains one of the most fragmented industries, you know, on the planet. And so given some of the trends that we've talked about, you know, fee pressures, cost pressures, you know, firms wanting to either expand their geographic footprint or gain access to, you know, new product vectors, whether that's alternatives or something else, I think it's probable that there will be significantly more merger and acquisition activity in the industry over the next 5 or 10 years as, you know, some of these large firms look to grow, look to rationalize. You know, typically when there is a transaction today, you know, you see a somewhere between 5 to 15% synergies realized between the two companies in terms of the entire cost base. So I think in an industry that is going to be lower growth, mature, we're talking about, you know, growth rates in the low single digits. Just like we've seen in the, you know, the banking industry, you know, over the last 20 years, there's going to be in all likelihood significantly more consolidation in what has historically been a very fragmented industry.
That's thank you, Perry, for that insight. Deborah?
Interesting. The one thing I was going to say was consolidation. So I absolutely agree with you, Perry. You know, we've seen it already. We've seen quite a lot of consolidation, especially with some of the, you know, the larger firms. I think we're continuing to see it. My view, you know, 5-10 years out, is that there will be two distinct, there will be the large global asset managers that have acquired or merged with others and just become bigger and have more capabilities. And then there'll still probably be a place for the small boutique niche firms that, you know, because I do see obviously areas such as private markets growing significantly over the next few years. And so some of those smaller private equity firms, private credit, alternative credit, hedge fund shops, maybe will continue to be able to operate on their own right. But the bigger will just keep getting bigger.
Right. So, you know, one of the final questions, I think we have a few minutes left, and we have a question from one of our listeners about the rise in AI ML usage in the asset management industry. I guess we did not touch upon it, but I guess there is a huge opportunity there, or is there? I mean, what do you feel about that? Deborah, do you want to comment on that?
Yeah, I mean, I can start, you know, from an Asian perspective, and obviously being very close to China, we are seeing that, you know, absolutely. You know, have to look at the significant, right, and especially during the COVID pandemic environment, I think it's highlighted it even more. You know, the face-to-face contact has obviously ceased, but people are still looking to invest assets, and so, especially in the, you know, the retail high net worth market, the use of online wealth platforms, fintech, you know, digitalization, it's huge. And the Chinese have been one of the best and, you know, early adopters of that technology. We saw it with Alibaba, Tencent, and it was seeing it with, you know, subsidiaries of theirs like Lu International in Hong Kong. You literally have to just click on your app. You can buy stocks, bonds, funds, everything you want, you know, all online, at low fees. And I, you know, I can see that trend definitely growing. In fact, you know, as a large global asset manager, it's something that we're talking about at BNY Mellon to see, you know, what type of technology we need to be integrating into our process right now so that we're not left behind.
Mm-hmm. Perry, your question.
Harsh, I think your comment also was sort of the utilization of AI, machine learning, big data in the investment process. At least, you know, that's one thing that I've that I've thought about, and you do see this. I'm not sure it's universal today across all of the large asset managers, but increasingly, and I know this is true at my old shop at Wellington, there's now a pretty large group that's dedicated to this. So you have, you know, the traditional fundamentally oriented investment teams that are looking at companies and valuations, but they're increasingly being supplemented by inputs, either quantitative inputs or big data mining inputs that may at the margin reveal some interesting trends or information that will affect some of your investment decision making. So I too think this is an important trend on the investment side of the house that is increasingly taking hold.
Mm-hmm. Sanjay?
Yes, I agree with what Deborah and Perry mentioned. I think that it's largely permeated the hedge fund industry and the alts area to a large extent, because we are seeing a lot of AI-driven quantitative long short strategies being marketed around in Asia and South Asia specifically on that basis. But I think it's something that trend that will continue to grow.
Great. So thank you, everybody. So we are almost out of time. And I would like to thank everyone for joining us as well today. Before we close, perhaps, one of the things that I wanted to, quickly summarize, given this discussion and your thoughts, is, there is a lot of ideas that there will be global integration going forward and consolidation going forward in the asset management industry, along with increased usage or increased focus on climate science, ESG, and other niche investments in the private markets, innovation on natural language processing, artificial intelligence, and big data applications in the space as well. Very quick reactions from you. So all of this, we need one more hour to discuss the impact of what regulation might be on all of these issues, right? Because it has global integration, you have regulators there, consolidation, you have regulators there, use of non-standard processes, you have a host of regulations there. Very quick reactions. What do you think? How should are regulators reacting to this in real time? Or is there is that something that needs further thought into and further discussion? Perry?
It's a highly regulated industry already. Whether it's here in the US, the SEC, the Fed, but it's also highly regulated in many of the mature markets around the world, Hong Kong, Singapore, Australia, the UK. I mean, it's very highly regulated. I think there'll be new vectors though for regulation and for guidelines. And so, I could see that evolving in terms of disclosures regarding ESG and things like that, that could be imposed on publicly traded companies. But I think for the most part, it's already a highly regulated industry. I know many of these large firms have significantly large compliance departments, legal departments. And so I don't think that's going away, and that there will be likely some new vectors for regulation going forward or disclosure that will be required.
Mm-hmm. Sanjay?
Well, I would second that. I think that the cost of operating an asset management business, the largest cost of operating an asset management business is really the compliance piece now. In fact, the compliance departments in most asset management businesses is larger than even the back office, for that matter, in some cases, or equal to that. So I think that specific to your question, I think regulators are behind the curve. They're relatively more reactive, and they haven't yet caught up, whether it's with ESG or whether it's with a lot of the trends that you see in terms of global integration. There really isn't a cohesive, what you would say, a regulatory framework out there of whether can you take a Japanese fund and say, for example, market that in Singapore today? Or can you take a US fund and market that? You know, and there's a lot of hurdles and there's a lot of regulatory compliances to be able to do something like that.
Right. Mm-hmm. Deborah?
Yep, absolutely agree. We are definitely in, you know, a highly regulated industry already. We are seeing that on one hand, the regulators are starting to step up. So, you know, they're issuing circulars, they're issuing guidelines around ESG, around sustainability or labeling your funds sustainable. They're issuing circulars around, you know, for example, you know, electronic data storage and things like that that we probably didn't have, you know, several years ago. But on the other hand, I agree with Sanjay, sometimes they're a little bit more reactive rather than proactive.
Well, thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. Thank you, Deborah. Thank you, Perry, for joining us. And thanks, everybody else, for joining us this morning. We will be sending out a short 2-minute survey following this event. And your feedback is important to us and will help us improve these in-person, you know, virtual as well as hopefully in the future in-person events as we continue. Have a great day and good morning and good evening to everyone.
Thank you.